Hello. So sometimes I just want to share something that I find exciting, and I don't know exactly why I'm doing this or who I'm speaking to, and I'm kind of curious who will be the people who would stumble upon this message. It makes me wonder. I wanted to talk once again about self-hypnosis and hallucinations. And here I have the book by Oliver Sacks, which is called Hallucinations, open it. And he notes that in some cultures, hallucinations are praised, like an ability to access something cool. But in other cultures, there is a stigma that hallucinations are somehow not safe. And I find this stigma to be a part of a wider behavioral pattern. A pattern of only doing what other people around a person, people that make up the person's network or the social panorama, the pattern of only repeating the behavior of this closest network, the network of school, of university, college, of workspace. So people often grow to depend on their network, and I would even say they are hooked, because there are hormonal and very strong chemical interactions happening in the brain that are bound to social relationships. So this is known in psychology, that a person who have a strong and fruitful social connections, they are kind of protected from the blunt of addiction. So nicotine addiction, alcohol addiction, drugs, they have a much weaker effect on people who have strong social connections. And one way to explain this is because these social connections are a source of endogenous opioids, and so essentially when a person have a network, they don't need drugs and addictions. They can feel good regardless of whether they are taking a drug or not. So addictions are much easier to drop for such. And this might be the reason of this network defined behavior, when a person only consider to be normal the behavior that is shown inside the network. So hallucination is one of such behaviors that are outside of some social networks, right? So people might look down. And another pattern perhaps is in confusing loss of control and more control. So sometimes a person is losing the control of their mind, losing the leverage that they would normally have, and their mind starts to behave in weird and strange ways. One of these weird ways is seeing hallucinations, dreams, right? But on the other hand, when a person trains their mind, when a person regains the control and and seeks to go beyond what normal people do, then they elicit this strange behavior too. So we can compare it to a gymnast or a martial artist. So if a person loses coordination, they instead of walking straight, they might walk strangely, like strange gait, strange pacing of the movement. You can see by observing the movement that they are not walking and not moving like a normal person, right? But when a person trains to be in sports, maybe do cartwheels or the rhythmic gymnastic here, or maybe they're doing a comedy like Charlie Chaplin and Buster Keaton did. When people for some reason try to master the movement, they move strangely as well. And if we have only a narrow definition of normalcy, of normal movement, then a movement of a person who can no longer control the muscles might look similar to us as a movement of a person who trains themselves to control the muscles better. Psychology is often less known to people than martial arts, and especially not just psychology, but psychotic techniques like hallucination. They are less known, and this leads to confusion, a loss of a control, and training and gaining much better control of consciousness. They think are confused by people from on the outside. They think that if a person uses self-hypnosis to facilitate hallucinations, that they're bonkers and they're going crazy, which is the opposite, because a person has learned of a much finer and much better control of the consciousness. So it's the opposite of insanity, right? I've been experimenting with hallucinations, and I've been doing this for more than a year now. But a year back, I wrote this text here, outlining the idea that we have different sides, different modes of view. And I remember an article, for example, that on Medical Express, that has found that children have a particular space in their brain that seems dedicated to animation. So when they see animation, when they imagine animation, it is a separate area from normal vision. And this matches with my experience, because when I facilitate hallucinations with self-hypnosis, I see different kinds of vision popping up. Some of them are like computer models. Today, even in movies, we see these three-dimensional animations. When much of a scene is rendered on a computational supercomputer of some kind. And with video games, nowadays we have such a supercomputer in a personal computer, embedded in a personal computer. So a video card is a supercomputer with a lot of parallel processing power. And it tends to have a particular style about it, more color, more like fog particle effects. It tends to be a bit richer and fantasy-like than just a video footage. Reminds me of surrealism a bit. And there is also drawings, sometimes on a video game or when certain films starts, like Netflix Jessica Jones, they have this beautiful animation at the start of the film, where we see drawings, but drawings enhanced with movement, with dynamism. For example, this simple video here, it basically pictures and text, but text that is also a leaf with color, with some. So what I'm seeing is that hallucinations can come in different styles. Sometimes they are realistic, and sometimes they are like drawings, like somebody painted a picture. And sometimes they are more alive, like drawings in a video game, and sometimes they are more passive, like a static picture. Sometimes it's like things are coming into the real vision, but not quite, so they are a bit like underwater. Because there is this gap between the real vision and the picture that is generated by a dream machinery, by the pictures that we can dream of. And in order for them to combine, this gap needs to be crossed. So sometimes when there is this connection between real vision and a dream, it is a bit like seeing things underwater. And sometimes one just flips into a dream and see with a dream sight something very, very precise, very detailed imagery, but with this feeling that this is not of the eyes. So these things, they can be experienced very differently and on different levels, and it's interesting to see this difference and different styles. So what I've been doing last couple of days is that I've figured this exercise where I play through a text interactive fiction game, which describes a scene, like here where we are visiting a dwarf king. And some games describe a scene in more detail, and some games more management focused, like when we are managing skills of a wizard here, or managing a corporation, a nation, or something like that. But even if the game gives us the barest minimum description of a scene, it still often places us somewhere in some situation that we can imagine. And here, with a bit of self-hypnosis, we can enhance this. And I find I find the beats helpful because anytime I see a scene in a game, I can just close my eyes and use the beats to repeat a self-hypnosis mantra. The beats help with focusing on it. And eventually the beats come around to the crossing. It gives a kind of a time frame for this, maybe one roll through the beats or two rolls through the beats, where I'm using self-hypnosis to start hallucinating seeing it, wondering what my psyche, my subconscious, or whatever it is at work, my dream site and dream machinery, what it will make of this scene and how it will draw it for me, and how it will decide to what art will it make on the. So I think it's a great way to enjoy text-based games and to train in self-hypnosis and to train in hallucination and in enhancing one's consciousness.